ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome the next governor and first lady of the great state of North Carolina, Dan and Alice Forrest.
Thank you so much for showing up today here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. It's a great crowd, and we appreciate you taking the time to join us. So today, I officially announce my candidacy for governor of the great state of North Carolina. You know, North Carolina is our home. It's the greatest state in America, and we're going to show the world why that's true. Yeah. Y'all go ahead and have a seat here. Going to be here a little while today. There's so many of you that have been with us from the very beginning, and that was quite a long time ago now, but we're so grateful you're like family to us, and it's just great to see you here. But I'm going to take just a moment to start this afternoon by acknowledging a few people, some that have already been acknowledged, but a few people for whom I'm especially grateful right now. First, Colonel Rabin. Colonel Rabin, where are you? Stay right behind me. Stand up, Colonel Rabin. Colonel Rabin, who offered our pledge today, is a highly decorated war hero, as you know, who led Special Operations Detachment in Vietnam and earned a Silver Star and a Bronze Star. He's also a former North Carolina State Senator. Colonel Rabin, thank you for your service to the nation and to the state, and thank you for being here today. Clarence Henderson, please stand and be recognized one more time. Clarence Henderson, who's with us. Another hero. Mr. Henderson has benefited our nation and our state in many ways through the years, including his service in the U.S. Army, his years as a teacher, and as a college administrator, but he is probably best known in his role for the civil rights movement back in the 1960s when he participated in the Woolworth sit-in right down the road in Greensboro to challenge racial inequality in the South. He's the champion for freedom and for conservative values. And Mr. Henderson, thank you for joining us today. In so many ways, you represent what's best about our state in the past and what's best about the future. Thank you for being here. And I would certainly be remiss as well if I didn't mention somebody who has been with me from the very beginning, literally the very beginning. My mother, Sue Myrick, is here. Mom, stand up. One of the things that people won't really remember is she charted the course for conservative women in politics. And she was not only on city council in Charlotte, but the first female mayor of Charlotte, and then served 9 consecutive terms as U.S. Congresswoman from the 9th District in Charlotte as well. And I can tell you from personal experience, because I travel this state and I meet so many people that say to me every single day, they ask me first, how's your mom doing? And then they say, you know what, your mom helped me, or my cousin, or my brother, or my aunt, or my uncle. And I think there's probably nobody in the state of North Carolina that has done more to help people across our state, one person at a time, the way a true public servant does. And so, Mom, I love you. Thank you for being here. And to each of you here today, thank you for coming to show your support and to get a peek into the things that we're going to do over the next few years as we set the stage to make North Carolina the greatest state in the United States of America. Now, let me start with a pledge to each of you and a pledge to all the people of North Carolina. I will run a campaign that appeals to your aspirations, not your fears. I will travel to all 100 counties, both large and small. I will lift up stories of people that are doing good to help their neighbors. Their stories will be the heart of my campaign. I will lift up the struggles of those who are in need. Their struggles will be the soul of my campaign. And I will celebrate the successes of our great state. These successes will be the strength of my campaign. I will not allow the mainstream media to filter my message. I will communicate directly with the people through social media. That's how you'll know what's going on. And I will not engage in divisive, negative campaigning or character assassination. That is my pledge to the people of North Carolina. As many of you already know, I'm not a career politician. I've done a lot of things over the years. I've cut grass and I've cleaned office buildings and I've painted houses. I've umpired baseball games and I've worked in retail. But for 21 years of my adult life, I was an architect. And I loved being an architect. As architects, we worked with just really, really creative people. People that had great visions and they solved complex problems and we watched those visions become reality. And when done right, architecture has the capacity to transform people's lives. Architects are visionary, they're creative problem solvers, and they're designers. They are consensus builders. But unfortunately, it's rare to find that sort of mindset in government. Government and vision are often at odds. For example, does anybody here even know if we have a state vision? I'm not sure anybody can really clearly answer that question right now, but that's what we're going to talk about today. And if the good people of North Carolina will push me to victory in 2020, we will design a vision, we'll create a plan, and we'll put together a team to lead North Carolina into the future. So what does that vision look like? Our campaign is about three very simple but significant ideas: unity, opportunity, and possibility. Unity, opportunity, and possibility. Let's first talk about unity. Unity almost feels like a bit of a foreign concept today. We have a real problem in North Carolina, and it's one that we see all across America. The problem is that there are people who are trying to divide us, following the playbook of identity politics. To some extent, these people have succeeded. They've created a toxic and polarized public square, a public square characterized by anger and fear. Politicians then kindle the flames of divisiveness because they can know they can raise more money if they scare enough people. The media, they pour gasoline on these flames because they know they can earn more ad revenue by making people angry and afraid, and by instead of giving them fair and balanced media and telling the truth. We used to call that reporting the news. But I can tell you this, in our campaign, we will reject identity politics. Identity politics represents the death of democracy. It threatens to burn down the house that our founding fathers built. And the people of North Carolina will not stand for it. We refuse to divide people into categories and put them in boxes with the expectation that you'll think the same way or believe the same way or act the same way. We refuse to sling dirt, peddle lies, or stoke hatred. That's not who we are. Instead, we're going to unite our state as one North Carolina. We're going to lift people up. and bring them together around North Carolina values. Things like hard work, personal responsibility, family values, and human dignity. Let's remind ourselves as the political battles heat up, we don't have a political problem in America, we have a moral problem in America. So let's take just a minute to talk about one of the big moral problems we face, the undermining of human dignity. I believe in human dignity because I believe that every human being is created in the image and likeness of God. I believe we all have the moral responsibility to love our neighbors, but especially the most vulnerable among us, the unborn, the newly born, the elderly, the orphaned, and the disabled. You would like to think that goes without saying, but in today's North Carolina, some people are sadly moving away from that ideal. In fact, Governor Cooper recently vetoed a bill that would have protected newborn babies born alive during the course of an abortion. That is the opposite of human dignity and runs counter to North Carolina values. So we're going to run a campaign that protects the intrinsic value of all life, one that respects the dignity of all people, unborn, newly born, elderly, black, white, and every other color. This belief in human dignity may start with a respect for life, but it overflows into an entire culture of respect. Respect for family, respect for parents, respect for teachers, respect for our laws and for our law enforcement and for our military men and women who put their lives on the line for our freedoms every day. And a respect for our flag and what it truly represents. With that, I know we have a lot of military veterans with us here in the crowd, but all the veterans of the military active duty, please stand so we can recognize you. When we join together, my friends, and we respect one another, and when we are united and not divided, and when we're all pulling in the same direction, I believe that there's no limit to what we can accomplish in our great state. So let's talk about that for a minute. Let's talk about opportunity. America has always been known as the land of opportunity, and we can make North Carolina that most shining example. Opportunity for our young people must start at home with family values. Morality, character, and personal responsibility. It then extends on to the community with institutions like the church that bind those families together. And when these institutions are lost, when we kick God and faith out of our homes, then we kick God out of our schoolhouse and our state house and our courthouse, what could possibly go wrong? Everything. We have too many young people today who are lost and lonely and depressed, anxious, confused, and even sometimes tragically killing themselves because of a sense of hopelessness. We need to work together, all of us, as a state, to give these young people hope and purpose and opportunity so that they know their great worth and their great value. And then we must focus opportunity on education. All children in North Carolina deserve the opportunity to receive a high quality education. So we are going to do something different and we're going to put students first. And let me tell you, the first thing we're going to do is give parents the ability to choose the school that works best for their child. Who wants a one-size-fits-all approach to education? What parent wants to be hemmed in, to be told that they cannot do for their children what is best for their education? Listen, we need to make sure that every child has access to the setting that is most effective for them, whether it's traditional public school, public charter school, private school, parochial school, or homeschool. And that includes access to opportunity scholarships, which give our state's low-income families a level playing field to access schools that can meet the needs of their students and give them hope and opportunity for a future. Believe it or not, there's people among us, there's educational elitists out there who believe that wealthy students should have this option, but not low-income students. And just last week, Governor Cooper said he wants to eliminate opportunity scholarships for our low-income families. Not on my watch. To focus on putting students first, we're going to work with the education leaders and the business leaders in our community to design an education platform from K-12 to university that is nimble and flexible, adaptive, and focused on preparing students not just for the jobs of today, but also for the jobs of tomorrow. And to put students first, we're going to work with our universities to ensure students have access to degrees that don't strap them with a lifetime of debt. We simply must stop the cycle of pushing kids into college, taking on too much debt, and then sending them out into the world with no marketable skills. So we're going to provide the type of education that'll make a parent proud and that'll prepare a student for the new opportunities of a modern economy. Which brings me to another point. We're not just talking about educational opportunity, we're talking about economic opportunity, and those two things go hand in hand. We will build an economy that supports all hardworking North Carolinians. Now, regardless of what Nancy Pelosi says, or regardless of what crazy Bernie says, or what AOC says, socialism does not work. In fact, there is no ideology in the history of the world that has failed people more totally. It promises liberation, social and economic liberation, but instead, it creates poverty and oppresses society. Socialism is a failed experiment for everyone except those who make the rules. Now, we have a lot of folks in our younger generation, and there's a lot of great young people in our state. We have a bit of a problem because a lot of our young people hear this word socialism, and they think it means social good. But young people, listen to me, and listen clearly. I'm not sure what they're teaching you in school about this, but socialism is as far away from social good as you can get. They're on opposite ends of the spectrum. Every single serious socialist experiment in history, the Soviet Union, the People's Republic of China, Fidel Castro's Cuba, and right now currently in South America, Venezuela, has brought with it either crushing poverty or totalitarian rule or both. It just plain doesn't work. So, while we may be told from those on the left, while we may be told from those in the media that there is a socialist revolution in the United States, not on our watch. Not on our watch. So my friends, you know this, but capitalism, despite any flaws, is absolutely the best system in the world for alleviating poverty and creating prosperity that the world has ever seen. In North Carolina, we can ensure that all of our businesses, big and small, have a level playing field to compete in a world market by supporting capitalism and a free market economy. So what are we going to do? We're going to continue to build a strong tax system that recognizes that families and small business owners make better decisions with their money than the government does. We're going to make smart investments in infrastructure and bring new businesses to every corner of our state. We're going to recruit innovative businesses in fields like aerospace, in advanced manufacturing, in regenerative medicine, and intelligent transportation, cybersecurity, biotechnology, and others, and increase the opportunity for venture capital dollars to flow into the state of North Carolina. And finally, unity and opportunity set the stage for possibility. Too often our leaders get stuck fighting yesterday's battles instead of setting a vision for the future and leading us into that future. You've probably heard the ancient proverb, where there is no vision, the people will perish. Well, I ask you this question again. What is North Carolina's vision? Where are we headed? How are we going to get there? Without a vision, our state will be destined to keep drawing on its past for inspiration and opportunity and hope. What we need is a new vision, a thoughtful plan, the right team to lead us into the future. What we need is a new governor. My friends, we all know this. We all know this. The world is getting smaller. The world's getting smaller, but competition is getting bigger. Every state in America and every country in the world are now competing for the same jobs. And North Carolina must be able to compete. Without a vision, we're on the sidelines of a modern economy. We have to be in the game if we want to win the game. Here's an example of what I mean. A few years ago, I had the opportunity to represent North Carolina at the International Air Show in Europe. CEOs from every single major aerospace company in the world were there. And you know what they said? They said they're looking to invest tens of billions of dollars right here in southeastern United States in the coming decade. Now, I was the only one there representing North Carolina at this air show, and by comparison, Alabama, who has a robust aerospace industry, they sent 80 people to the show. 80. North Carolina 1, Alabama 80. And that's not a college football score. They had their governor, their U.S. senators, members of the state legislature, business leaders, you name it, they were there. So how do you explain this? You explain it this way. We're not in the game. We're not winning the game because we're not in the game. If you want to be in the game, you have to field a team. You need a playbook. You need passion and perseverance, and you need to go after it. That's why Alabama is a leader in aerospace, and North Carolina is not. It's time for a governor who has a vision for our great state and is willing to do the hard work to create a plan, to put together the right team, and ensure North Carolina is not only in the game, but winning the game. Yeah. All it takes, and I want you to hear me now, all it takes is for the good people of North Carolina to say it's time for a change. All it takes is for the good people of North Carolina to join me in this vision. So when we think about possibility, we think about what the future can be like. We can put an end to the political divisiveness and hatred we've seen in our nation. We can unify together as one North Carolina. We can provide educational and economic opportunities, the likes of which North Carolina has never seen. We can seize the opportunity before us for our young people and for our struggling communities. We can build a better future by building a better government, one of the people, by the people, and for the people. Instead of fighting yesterday's battles, we can live in the exciting world of the possibility. This is where we're headed. Unity, opportunity, and possibility. if you'll join me. Let's work together toward a vision that lifts up all North Carolinians and sets the stage for a prosperous future. Political integrity demands it, and the people of North Carolina deserve it. So let's get started today. Thank you. May God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America.
And there you have it. The next governor of the great state of North Carolina, Dan Forrest, currently our lieutenant governor, but God willing, with the work of all of us here in North Carolina and across the country, he'll be our next governor, Lieutenant Governor Dan Forrest, running for governor of North Carolina. Officially launching today, we've got a long road ahead of us, over a year until we get to November of 2020. There's a lot of work to do, and we need you on the team. Go to danforrest.com, danforrest.com for all the details. If you want to join the Dan Forrest team, and why would you not? That's my question for you. Why would you not want to join the Dan Forrest team to be the next governor of the great state of North Carolina? DanForrest.com or text Forrest2020 to 91096. Text Forrest2020 all together. Ram that all together. Forrest2020 to 91096 or visit DanForrest.com. He is a great man, a family man, a great husband, a great father, a great Christian, a great American, a great conservative, a great thinker with a big, compassionate heart, an excellent communicator, but a down-to-earth communicator. Dan Forrest doesn't pontificate from the tops of the political heaps. He comes down to the street level because that's where he lives. That's who he is. And hopefully, God willing, with your work, with my work, with all of our work, he'll be the next governor of the great state of North Carolina. DanForrest.com is the website, DanForrest.com. Or text Forrest2020 to 91096. Forrest2020 to 91096. My name is Steve Noble, if you just joined us recently. And whether you're here in North Carolina or across the country, we need you to be involved. If you're in North Carolina, we need you to be involved as ground troops. You need to be engaged. Don't sit and watch this from the sidelines, assuming that he's going to win. Don't make that assumption. You have to get in the game. We have to, just like the song in the background, join together with this band of people that want to see North Carolina moving into the right future. Governor Cooper is the wrong governor all the time. Dan Forrest is the right governor for this time. You need to go to danforrest.com or text Forrest2020 to 91096. Danforrest.com or Forrest2020 to 91096. Again, this is Steve Noble, the Steve Noble Show. I've been a friend of Dan's for years. He and his wife and his four kids. I've taught two of his kids in my Constitution and Civics and Ethics courses. He is a wonderful, powerful, high integrity, high character, honest, hardworking American man who loves the Lord, who loves his family, who loves his fellow citizens, and loves this state. North Carolina needs Dan Forrest to be the next governor. And God willing, and with our work, we'll do it together. So go to danforrest.com or text Forrest2020 to 9106. Danforrest.com or text Forrest2020 to 91096. This is Steve Noble for the Dan Forrest campaign on Facebook Live. We're out. Pray for Dan. Get involved. DanForrest.com or text Forrest2020 to 91096.